Call this meeting to order. Today is Monday, March 20th, 2017. We're here for the purpose of the regular meeting of the Elmhurst City Council. It is 8 o'clock. We're starting a little late because we do early voting here at City Hall, and that goes till 7:30, so we give them about a half hour to clean up. I'd like to start with the Pledge of Allegiance. I'd ask that you all rise and join me in the pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Clerk, whoop, you okay there, Jim? Clerk Spencer, I'd ask that you call the roll.
York.
Here.
Toledo.
Here.
Healy.
Here.
Levin, absent. Kennedy.
Here.
Honquist.
Here.
Wagner.
Here.
Mullener.
Here.
Deuter.
Here.
Sabatino.
Here.
Leader.
Here.
Dunn.
Here.
Graham.
Here.
Palumski.
Here.
13 present, one absent.
13 present, one absent. We have a quorum. To get started, I'm going to ask Coach Dean Jensen. Oh, he's way ahead of me. I ask him to meet me over at the podium. Have that removed. Okay. As council will know, and audience, that whenever we have state champions in the city of Elmhurst, we like to bring them before council and give them proper recognition. I guess this is germane based on everything you see and read in the news these days, but we have a group of young kids here who won their Cyber Patriot Challenge. Is that a fair way of putting it?
Yes.
Okay, so they have this, the Air Force Association puts on an event where they actually call them modules, call them what you will, but they actually throw problems at these kids, and they have to figure out how to secure this stuff, how to store it, how to protect it. And out of 1,700 participants, these young students not only came in first in the state of Illinois, but they won their region as well, right? So I'm very happy to say that I have a proclamation, as Alderman York will attest to. If I touch anything electronic, I break it. So maybe these kids can help me. But it is my honor. I'm not going to read the whole thing, but I will say that whereas the team of York High School students, including Joseph Black, Evan Mills, Brandon Musgrave, Emilio O'Halloran, Brian Strouch, and Alex Swinford. Did I miss anybody? Very nice. Recently concluded an exceptional four rounds of competition against over 1,700 other high school teams in Cyber Patriot, the National Youth Defense Competition. Now, therefore, I, Steve Morley, Mayor of the City of Elmhurst, extend congratulations and pride of the Elmhurst community and here do by proclaim March 20th, 2017 as Elmhurst Cyber Club Day. Let's give him a round of applause. I want to give Coach Jensen an opportunity to explain much better what they did and invite the kids on up here. So, Coach?
Sure, thank you. If I can actually get everybody up here, because they really did the work. So my name is Dr. Jensen. I work at Elmhurst College. It's been my pleasure for the last 3 years to work with this group of fine students from York High School. In a Cyber Patriot program. So the U.S. Air Force Association is trying to encourage students to get involved in science, technology, engineering, and math, STEM. A group of students at York, primarily Molly, 3 years ago had the bright idea that, hey, let's form this cyber club. We got affiliated with the U.S. Air Force Association. They give us various problems, computer images to secure, to protect. There's a knowledge base on proving computer networking skills, very challenging. And luckily, this group of fine students for the third year in a row has won the state competition. For the second year in a row, they have won the Midwest Regional Competition and have come oh so close to the national competition, which is hopefully our goal for next year. So really, it is Molly, Joseph, Alex, Brendan, and Evan, who did all the work.
Congratulations.
Watch your step. Congratulations. Watch your step.
Congratulations.
Watch your step.
Congratulations.
Watch your step.
Great job.
That's awesome.
Good job. That's awesome.
Yeah, you got a good job.
Representing us so well.
Congratulations.
There you go.
Congratulations.
Congratulations.
Representing us well.
Thank you for coaching that.
Good luck. Congratulations.
Congratulations.
Thanks for coming out.
Well done.
Yes. Helping the kids out, too.
Watch your step.
Congratulations.
Congratulations. Well done.
Congratulations.
Well done.
Well done. Congratulations.
Thank you very much. Take care.
Congratulations.
Well done.
Watch your step,
sir.
Congratulations. Watch your step.
Yes. Always stay in the good position.
This is...
Let's see my training.
Doctor, you have one kid.
Yeah.
I think we got room here. Can you put us in this chamber? Shot D. She's got me cut off. That's why I
don't remember you ever looking back.
Oh, boy.
Boys will be boys, I'm sure.
You're half the size.
You ever do anything?
Oh, God, yeah, where's the plaque?
You may throw it to you?
Prosperity, baby? I don't know.
Right.
Mike, is one of those yours?
Wait.
All right, so I'll
be seeing you. All right, because they know how to do all that stuff.
You guys want to move step forward in college?
Yeah.
Very nice. All right, another round of applause.
Okay, very good. We'll give parents and students alike. You're more than welcome to stay, but you can leave if you want.
Here's their detailed budget.
Okay. Great to see that kind of thing. On to agenda item 4, receipt of written communications. At this time, is there anyone in the audience who has any written communications they wish to submit? Please raise your hand if you have any written communications you wish to submit. Seeing none, we'll move on to agenda item 5, public forum. This is an opportunity for anybody in our audience to address the council on any item they so choose. We ask that out of respect for the work that we have to get done here this evening, that you keep your comments to 3 minutes, and out of respect for other folks who may want to speak. If you go over your 3 minutes, I will give you a gentle reminder and ask you to wrap up your comments. I ask that we also ask that all comments be directed to the chair. Clerk Spencer, at this time, is there anybody who has signed up for public comment?
Yes, Mayor. I'll start with Reverend Matt Parker Resch.
And before I let you get started, we ask that we are recording this. We ask that you identify yourself at the microphone behind you. We ask that you identify yourself when you get started, address is optional. The floor is yours.
My name is Matt Parker Resch. I am the pastor for Yorkfield Presbyterian Church. And do I address from this microphone?
That's it. Okay. You're doing great.
Okay. Dear Mayor Morley and members of the council, thank you for allowing me to speak tonight. I come to you both as the pastor of Yorkfield Presbyterian Church, as well as the convener of the Elmhurst Interfaith Leadership Network, a consortium of religious leaders from Elmhurst and the surrounding communities. My purpose here tonight is to encourage you as leaders to continue to make our community a place where all are welcome and a place where we accept one another. As local representatives that are charged with directing the course of city government, you have been chosen by the people of the city to both represent and guide them. As a religious leader, I firmly believe that we are called to be in community, to understand and respect one another, and to recognize and affirm one another as part of creation. As people from a variety of different faith backgrounds, we are called to welcome the stranger and to seek peace and reconciliation in the world. Over the past 2 months, events on the national level have effectively heightened the level of fear of the other, raised general concern and suspicion, and elevated expressions of hate and mistrust within communities throughout the nation. The recent budget presented by the White House on Thursday seeks to drastically reduce funding for low-income families, the environment, community development block grant programs, which tangibly support our elder populations, along with public education programs and other entities. Additionally, the revised executive order for the travel ban alleged a risk of letting in people the administration feels would intend to do Americans harm. Although contested and stopped by the federal district court, it continues to be debated. These recent events make each of us wonder, what can we do personally? How can individuals make a difference? Tonight, I come to you as our local elected officials to encourage you, as you represent your constituencies, to continue a work for peace and reconciliation within our community. First, I encourage you to continue conversations of collaboration among neighbors rather than allowing the rhetoric of hate to have a voice. Encourage neighbors and communities to come together. Let us not distrust or be suspicious of each other simply because we are different, but rather let us learn more about each other and share in this life together. Instead of talking about building walls, encourage us to build divides, to bridge divides, and to step into places of vulnerability. Recently, it was brought to my attention that there were symbols of hate that were spray painted near the prairie path in Elmhurst. We ask that you do not dismiss this as an act of juvenile naivete, but understand it for what it represents, a hatred. I applaud the work of the Elmhurst Park District, which is actively working to remove these symbols, and may we all actively work to promote love and not hate. Second, I encourage you to speak for inclusiveness and promote a sense of welcome within our community. Allow schools and places of worship to be sanctuaries where individuals are safe from deportation and harassment. Continue to allow Elmhurst to be a place that is safe for all, a place that is welcoming to all. The recent travel ban, along with such initiatives, present a hardship to many of our local students and families. Please use your voice to speak against oppression and distrust, and continue to allow Elmhurst to be a community that is welcoming and kind. Third, I encourage you to continue your support for programs that serve our most vulnerable, as well as to be good stewards of the environment. Protect programs that assist the elderly and poor with the rising cost of heating and utilities. Safeguard programs that help those in need. Support legislation and initiatives that protect the environment. How can you, as leaders of Elmhurst, make a difference in this world? As a community, we are each made up as individuals, and I come to you not only as an individual voice, but as a collective of many voices that seek to promote peace and welfare. Do not let the voice of distrust and hate heard recently gain a foothold in our community. But when you speak to residents, other officials, including representatives in state and national offices, we ask that you use your voice to promote peace and care for one another. Encourage your state and national representatives to maintain programs that feed the hungry, house the homeless, and provide for the poor. Preserve the environment and fragile natural resources that are entrusted into our care. As elected officials who care for the world and for one another, we ask that you would make a difference in this administration, in this community, in this nation, and in the world. I thank you for your service. Thank you.
Claude Pagash, 566 West Gladys.
Claude Pagash, 566 West Gladys. I personally would like to say that this council did a disservice when they voted in the $85,000 to have somebody remodel a building so they could move into it. That was bad enough. But to tie up this council with a five-year deal, what makes you all believe you're going to be here 5 years from now? There will be a council and there will be a mayor. But you've locked them in. Why? The $85,000 was bad enough. But you locked in future councils and mayors to a deal that you cut. Let's hope 5 years from now you're sitting there. On the agenda, we have a design for a heating system for the police station. For the 2 years and more that I've come here, there's been a structural problem with that police station. Back engineers must have looked at it because there was a contract to try to stabilize it. Now you're going to spend $500,000 to put in a new heating system in a structure that is structurally unsound. I doubt if you do it at your own home, but you're going to do it tonight, aren't you? Very nice. We have this industrial drive. We got money from the federal government to put a new street in down there. Residents have asked for new streets, but Industrial Drive is going to get one. But not all the money is there. So let's pose the problem where the rest of the money comes from. Secondly, if the resident wants a sidewalk, you assess them for it. Is that going to hold true for Industrial Drive? Or is that going to come out of the resident's pocket? Interesting question, isn't it? But I doubt if it'll be debated. We're going to have general obligation bonds come up again tonight. I wish finance would do one thing, not just talk about the change, but to admit to this town just what the total volume of general obligation bonds they're on the hook for. Because we always talk about change, but we never want to state just how much this town and administrations have locked the residents into.
Mr. Pagosh, I'd ask you to wrap up your comments.
So let's be honest with the public tonight about this industrial drive, about these general obligation bonds, about the $500,000 you want to spend on a police station for a heating system and a structure that's not sound. Let's have a little debate.
John Quigley, Elmhurst Chamber of Commerce.
Good evening, John Quigley, President and CEO, Elmhurst Chamber of Commerce and Industry. As you are all well aware, it is the responsibility and in the power of those on the dais to make decisions that impact Elmhurst residents and businesses on a day-to-day basis. But as you also know, it is at the committee level where the foundation of your decisions are laid. I'm here tonight to thank the Development Planning and Zoning Committee, chaired by Scott Levin and vice-chaired by Mark Mulliner, for its hard work in recent months on economic redevelopment initiatives from Brewpoint Coffee to Fitness Formula Club, from Opus to Mladenov Daycare, and tonight again, New Home Star. Thanks to the DPZ Committee's work in particular and the City Council in general, Elmhurst enjoys unparalleled success across DuPage County and throughout suburban Chicagoland for both residential and commercial redevelopment, the envy of our peers. Even in times of contentious debate, our municipal government has found a way to do what's best for Elmhurst. If only our federal and state governments could learn from our example. And oh yes, it doesn't hurt that we have one of the best chambers in the state in Elmhurst as well. Thank you.
That is all that signed in tonight.
Okay, that's it for public forum for those who signed in. Is there anybody in the audience who wishes to speak who did not have an opportunity to sign in on our sign-up sheet but wishes to address the council at this time? If so, please raise your hand. I see one. Anyone else? Ms. Sullivan, you're it.
Read a report.
Good evening. Sorry, Kathleen Sullivan. I neglected earlier this month to recognize that it was 8 years that I've been coming to City Council to talk about the issues of my neighborhood. And last night, of course, I had plenty of time to reflect while the storms went on and we were listening to them. So so I wanted to do that, as well as right now we're still waiting on the land transfer so that we can start construction on the project that affects my neighborhood. And it's been sitting in the state for over 6 weeks, a process that was supposed to take 30 days. And to my knowledge, and I will be clarifying that this week, but I don't know that it's gone yet to the federal government, which also has to approve it. And so, you know, we really, really sit there and experience so much stress in our neighborhood with this project not done and can't make plans for this summer and things like that. So we really do want the attention shown on this project and getting that land transfer accomplished. Thank you.
Okay, anyone else? Seeing none, we'll move on. That concludes public forum announcements. Any announcements from the dais? Clerk Spencer.
Okay. I just want to announce again at this council meeting that City Hall Council Chambers is hosting early voting for the April 4th election. The time is Monday through Friday, 8:30 to 7:30, Saturdays 9 to 5, and it will conclude on April 1. It started today. I hope we had a big turnout. I didn't hear. And this also is a polling place on Tuesday, April 4th, for the election. I'm not sure who votes here. I can't answer that question or any other polling question, but I wanted to announce that the DuPage election can, and the number is 630-407-5600 if you don't know where to vote on April 4th.
Clerk Spencer, one question for you. Does our early voting go through the Friday before or the Saturday before?
The Saturday before.
So we're open on the Saturday?
Yes.
Here from 1
to
1?
9 to 5.
9 to 5. Okay, because there was some confusion coming out of the county during our last election. So April, what is that?
One. We're called a temporary location, and that goes to Saturday.
Okay.
Permanent locations are open all the way until Monday, the night before the election.
Okay, thanks for the clarification.
Thank
Alderman
you.
Alderman Healy.
Thank you, Mayor. As council is aware, Public Affairs and Safety Committee is tackling a fairly significant issue. With next week being spring break, one of the aldermen on the committee was going to be out of town, so we felt it important to not cancel the meeting because of some time issues. So we are going to meet this Thursday, 6 p.m. in our normal meeting room 2. 6 p.m. this Thursday, Public Affairs and Safety will meet.
Okay, Thursday the 23rd. Anyone else? Alderman Dunn.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Mayor. Just to follow up on the topic of elections that Clerk Spencer was talking about, for those that are living on the north side of town in Addison Township, there's a couple, three different propositions appearing on the ballot this year. One dealing with homeowners exemptions, a second one dealing with consolidation of government services, and the third one dealing with the Fly Quiet program that we've been discussing off and on here at City Council. So for those in Addison Township, I'd ask you to pay special attention to your ballot and those particular questions. Thanks.
Okay, any other announcements? Seeing none, we'll go on to consent agenda at this time. Is there any item on the consent agenda any alderman wishes to have removed, to vote no, or to provide further comment? Anything removed from consent agenda? Alderman Wagner.
7.31, Mayor.
7.31. Alderman Bram, you had your hand up?
Yes, sir. 7.6.
7.6. Anyone else? I will now entertain a motion to approve the consent agenda minus items 7.6 and 7.31. Motion to approve. Motion by Alderman Deuter, second by Alderman Bram. Clerk Spencer.
I have the wrong folder here. reason. Okay, excuse me. I have to get another form here. I had the wrong sheet.
Thank you.
Okay, York?
Aye.
Toledo?
Aye.
Healy?
Aye.
Levin, absent. Kennedy?
Aye.
Honquist?
Aye.
Wagner?
Aye.
Mulliner?
Aye.
Deuter?
Aye.
Sabatino?
Aye.
Leader?
Aye.
Dunn?
Aye.
Graham?
Aye.
Polumsky?
Aye.
13 ayes, 0 nays, 1 absent.
13 ayes, 0 nays. Motion carries. Agenda item, I'm sorry, consent agenda is approved minus item 7.6, 7.31. On to agenda item 7.6, a report out of Public Works. Clerk Spencer, I'd ask that you read the recommendation.
It is therefore the recommendation of the Public Works and Buildings Committee that the unit bid price from the lowest possible bidder, J.A. Johnson Paving Company, for the 2017 contract paving program not exceed the budget amount of $3,092 be accepted, and the city attorney be authorized to prepare the necessary city council documents. Signed by Jim Kennedy, chairman, Marty Deuter, vice chairman, Patrick Wagner, unsigned by Michael J. Bram.
Okay, to put this before council, I ask for a motion to approve the report and recommendation is read. Motion by Alderman Kennedy, second by Alderman Deuter. Alderman Kennedy, your report.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. This is an annual expenditure for streets that need to be repaved throughout the city. What city staff does, as they look out 3 to 5 years, put together a plan of those streets in most need of repair, and then prior to the actual year in which the work is done, they'll look at what they've believed to be those streets that are in the greatest need of repair, look at all streets in general, and then come up with a final determination of what streets indeed need to be the most, are in the greatest need of being repaved. So there is some movement from year to year, as there's different wear rates on different streets, but this report puts forth those streets that are in greatest need of repair at this time. Thank you.
No internet. All of New York, my computer's broken.
Find that.
Any additional comments? Alderman Graham.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. We had a very good debate, and as Alderman Kennedy has already stated on this, this is reviewed every year. A few years ago, we did create an overall, at least concrete street plan, and that is my concern with this proposed contract paving year today. In that plan, and up until, at least to my knowledge, last Monday, there were three streets in the concrete area in my ward, in the third ward, that were planned to be repaved, overlay with asphalt. And I believe, from memory, I believe it was Gladys Armitage and Belden. What is proposed with this agenda item is the removal of those three streets for this paving year, but the addition, if you will, and I put that in quotes, the addition of Van Auken and Crestview. Van Auken and Crestview have not been repaved for 2 to 3 years due to the fact of the hope of the city of Elmhurst acquiring outside Elmhurst funds. I don't recall if it was federal or state, but in this discussion, it's irrelevant. Due to the fact of that delay of 2 years and not being able to acquire these funds, the city has decided to move forward with doing the asphalt overlay of these two streets. To my, at least, surprise, with my many conversations prior to the meeting this past Monday night, because those were inserted for this paving year, the other three streets, Gladys Armitage and Belden, were moved out indefinitely. I do thank city staff. I did meet with the city engineer following our last Monday meeting, and we did go over the impacts here. Wasn't anything in certainty on when these three streets will be done, but the residents in my area were expecting these streets to be done, and actually a resident was here a couple of weeks ago speaking about Gladys, which is in front of his house, and the poor condition that it was in. I just wanted to add, what really caused me some concern was, yes, they're reevaluated year to year, but one, if not two, of the streets that are now part of this year's plan, concrete streets that are part of this year's plan to be redone with asphalt overlay, weren't part of the plan this year, weren't part of the plan next year or the following year. They were marked as 2020 and beyond. So I asked the question and why that is, and I don't have the answer even today on why those were pulled in when they weren't in the plan even 3 to 4 to 5 years out, bless you. But the streets that were planned for this year got moved out. So I can't support this. The residents in this area have been waiting a very long time to see these streets being redone, and I'm happy that we have not only a program and a plan, but to some degree an accelerated program and plan. But I am disappointed to see streets that weren't within the realm of 3 to 5 years in this year's plan, and streets that were for this year totally moved out within an undetermined date on when they will be done.
Any other comments? Seeing none, I'll ask Clerk Spencer to call the vote.
York.
Aye.
Toledo.
Aye.
Healy.
Aye.
Levin, absent. Kennedy.
Aye.
Honquist.
Aye.
Wagner.
Aye.
Mulliner.
Aye.
Deuter.
Aye.
Sabatino.
Aye.
Leader.
Aye.
Dunn.
Aye.
Graham.
No.
Polumsky.
Aye.
12 ayes, 1 nays, 1 absent.
All eyes on the motion carries. Agenda item 7.6 is approved. On to 7.31. This is an ordinance. Clerk Spencer, and I ask that you read the ordinance.
An ordinance granting a conditional use permit for the purpose of allowing a daycare center on the property commonly known as 187 through 195 North York.
Okay, to put this before council, I ask for a motion to approve the ordinance as read. Motion by Alderman Mulliner. Second by Alderman Honquist. Alderman Mulliner, Alderman Wagner, you pulled this.
Thank you, Alderman Mulliner. I did. Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I just kind of wanted to recap. I was disappointed. I was intending to be here at the meeting 2 weeks ago and wasn't. I was stuck in Boston. And unfortunately, I wasn't able to call in either. But I was disappointed in the outcome. I'm a big believer in that most of the debate happens under the reports and not the ordinance, so I'm not here to necessarily debate it, but I felt obligated to at least give my take on my support at the time for the minority report and not for the majority report. Unfortunately, the majority report won out. But I do think that this is a dangerous situation to put ourselves as the council approving this for the residents of Elmhurst, because I do think that that location is not good. It's not that we don't want the daycare anywhere near downtown in the central business district. It's just not the right location, and I think we're taking a huge risk by doing it. I don't know. I don't remember another time, and there must have been another time because I've only been here for 8 years, that we did not take the commission report. We did not take in the staff report. We did not take in the Elmhurst Fire Department or the Elmhurst Police Department's recommendation that that location not be used. So we've made the decision as a council to put forward that location, and I hope I'm wrong. I really do. At the end of the day, I won't be here in this seat when school does reconvene, hopefully in September, or maybe they go through the summer. But I do want to point out, I don't know how many people took the opportunity to go to the current location of the Kids Drops area, but I was there and I almost got hit. So I just think that I don't know if York Street drop off or pick up or the alley drop off or pick up was given as much consideration as I think it may have should have. I know there was a couple meetings from the DPZ committee that they did probably discuss it. Unfortunately, I didn't attend any of them, so I do apologize, but I just want to make this point. So, and let you know why I won't be supporting the ordinance. And it's very rare that I don't support an ordinance
particularly as a majority, but I just felt the need that it's not the right thing to do, and I didn't want to go on record as having been part of the majority as approving it. So thank you, Mr. Mayor. Just want to let everybody know.
Okay, any other comments? Clerk Spencer.
York.
No.
Toledo.
Aye.
Healy.
Aye.
Levin, absent. Kennedy.
Aye.
Honquist.
No.
Wagner.
No.
Mulliner.
Aye.
Deuter.
Aye.
Sabatino.
Aye.
Leader.
No.
Dunn.
Aye.
Graham.
Aye.
Malumski.
Aye.
Nine ayes, three nays, one absent.
I got four nays.
Oh, excuse me. I just met. Honquist, Wagner, Leader.
York.
Oh, York. I didn't see that up there.
He's right next
right
to you.
There is the glow of the light. Yeah. My computer. Okay. Let's start this over. 9-4-1. Okay.
Nine ayes, four nays. Motion carries. Agenda item 7.13 is approved. 7.31 and 1-3 as well.
All right. Pardon me.
Your computer.
Notice your grips are worn, sir. Okay. On to agenda item 8.1. This is a report out of finance. Clerk Spencer, I'd ask that you read the recommendation.
It is therefore the recommendation of the Finance, Council Affairs, and Administrative Services Committee that the City Council authorize the sale of a 2017 general obligation bond issue in the amount of $10 million to be used to finance the upcoming water meter change out project and for repair and replacement improvements to the wastewater treatment plant as detailed above per the 2017 budget document. Signed by Kevin L. York, Chairman, by Bob Dunn, Vice Chairman, Noel P. Toledo, and Mark P. Sabatino.
Okay, to put this before council, I'll ask for a motion to approve the report and recommendation is read. Motion by Alderman York, second by Alderman Dunn. Alderman York, your report.
Thank you, Your Honor. The report spells everything out pretty clearly, so I'll just kind of touch on some of the highlights. There's a couple projects outlined here. One is the change out of the water meters. It's going to be accomplished over a year or two period. We have to buy the water meters and get those changed out, $7 to $8 million. We did an emergency repair on the south digester. That was $2 million, so this is the money to pay for those items. The bond market is still very good. It's a GO bond. GO bonds provide the lowest interest rate possible. We talked about a lot of different alternatives, but due to the fact that they're 15-year property, pretty much, we went with a 15-year bond, saves us about 25 basis points. This is going to be the revenue to pay the debt service on these bonds is from user fees on the utility billing. So it's already in the budget for the water rates and the sewer rates, and it's collected through this CERC charge that we have, the capital improvement recovery charge. It's applied evenly based on usage and meters. So I'd be happy to answer any questions that anybody might have, but all the information is there. And this is in the budget. This was in the budget for 2017.
Okay, any comments? Alderman Wagner.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Alderman York, I'm just curious, the rate that was given, obviously it's very good, but I seem to remember getting a better rate maybe even 6 months ago. Are rates creeping up that fast? And have we accounted for that for any future spending that we need for any stormwater projects coming up to take advantage of maybe some lower rates now, as everybody's all aware of the national situation of the quarter point increase in the next, you know, every quarter from here on out through the end of the year? I just maybe want to just, if you could highlight your thoughts on that.
Alderman York?
Obviously, rates are going up, as you mentioned, with the Fed rates and everything. And Our consultants from Spear Financial kind of indicated that these were kind of baked into the rates that are in the marketplace now. So we think these are really good rates. Municipal bond rates tend to be a little bit lower because they're tax advantaged. So it's still a great way, not that we had the cash just to go out and buy it. We don't have any other alternatives here. So this is a way to match the revenues and the expenses and really a very good deal. So.
Any other comments? Pluto.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I'd like to point out that in the report, we address the outstanding general obligation debt. It is stated that it is at an amount after this issue of around $86 million. And put that into perspective, that's around 4% of the total EAV for the city of Elmhurst. Our policy, we self-impose a policy which limits us to no more than 5% of our EAV of general obligation bonds that we issue. So we're still under our own policy. And to further put that into perspective, non-home rule communities in the state of Illinois limit themselves or are limited by state law to 8.5% of total EAV. So we are being very conservative here in what we're issuing, and we need this money to pay for the water meter replacement. Finally, I will encourage anyone in the public or anyone in the dais to join any of our finance meetings. We are going through a whole comprehensive debt policy review. We're going through all of the debt that we do have, how we're paying it back, and we're reviewing what we think our policy should be in the future. So if anyone has any questions, please join us at our finance committee meetings. Thank you.
Okay, any other comments? Alderman Bram.
Thank you. And Alderman, I want to thank Alderman Toledo for highlighting that because it is a self-imposed policy of 5%, but we are creeping ever so close as the years go by towards that 5%. And it does cause me some concern that we are moving in that direction. My one question may be for the chairman, but I think it's actually probably more for the director of finance of, do we see any other than possible additional stormwater projects, anything else that we may need to go out to GO bond for in the near term while we're hovering at 4% today?
Let me put the city manager on the spot with that. Any GO bond issues planned? We can certainly throw it over to Tom, but in our budget, did we call for any more? Alderman Bram already mentioned stormwater, which is kind of an ongoing issue that we will evaluate.
I'm getting a nod from Tom that we don't have it in the budget this year, and I think we'd want to get back to the council on the future as we look at the five-year capital plan as we do each year for the budget, if that would be all right.
Okay, thank you.
Alderman York.
Thank you, Your Honor. Yeah, so that's a real accurate answer. When we're looking especially at the water rates and so on and so forth, there are additional capital expenditures I don't know exactly what there are from year to year, but as we replace and renew, and then there's always the unfunded mandates that come down, like we have to get, and I'm making stuff up right now, zinc out of the system or whatever, and it costs us $3 million to do it. Really no other way. There's not, the cash balances are very low in this fund, and we've got no way to finance anything like that. So we do have GO bond obligations projected into the future. But as I reminded everybody at the end of the last meeting too, we paid off $4.5 million worth of GO bond principal just 2 weeks ago. So there's adding and there's subtracting. There's adding and there's subtracting. And as Alderman Toledo mentioned too, the committee has taken a look at all these items because, yes, we have general obligation debt. That's no mystery to anybody, and it's printed in here exactly what it is. But we have revenue sources for some of these general obligation bonds, and knock on wood, there's only marble here, but we've been able to get back to the point where we're abating all the general obligation debt. So we're in good shape now, but we're not sitting back on our laurels and just accumulating debt for no apparent reason. I'm not suggesting you're saying we are, but it's a critical element of the financing of the city.
Alderman Wagner.
I was going to ask Alderman York, and Mr. Mayor, you may be able to answer this question as well. And Alderman York alluded to abating bonds. There may be some people watching out there that just don't really have an idea what that means. Could you help maybe explain to the residents that what that means?
Sure. We have, whenever we issue a GO bond or any GO, any debt, we have an opportunity to pass along the debt service cost every year to our residents. In 2008 or 2009, when we were in a serious financial crunch, we actually did. The city was carrying some debt, and we used to abate or pay on behalf of our residents that obligation. For probably 4 years there, we chose not to abate, which means we actually passed along this debt obligation to our residents, and they saw an increase overall in their property tax bill. Well, right now, and it was part of the plan that Alderman York and his committee put together a couple years ago, the plan was to get to a point where not only did we retire debt, but we would abate all of the debt payments on behalf of the residents of Elmhurst. It's a practice that we did for probably 20 or 30 years. During the tough times, 2008, 2009, for a couple years, we shifted that burden over to the residents. They did their part. City tightened its belt, got back on its feet, and I'm happy to say, Alderman Wagner, that the debt that we're issuing, we're still paying for those obligations on a yearly basis and not passing along to our residents at this time. Fair?
Thank you
for explanation.
Explaining that. I was certainly aware of it, but I think there are some people watching or out there that maybe had some questions about it. So thank you for clearing it up.
Okay. Anyone else? Alderman Bram.
Yeah, I just want to say that my question wasn't trying to allude to the fact that I had any concerns over this. This is definitely, these bonds are definitely needed. What the bonds are targeted for, the water meters and the other repairs at the water treatment plant, is definitely a necessity. No two ways about it. But I also want to keep an eye on the ball, and I know the finance committee is doing so as we speak and moving forward about how we're utilizing our debt and what is possibly down the road.
Okay, any other comments? Seeing none, I'll ask Clerk Spencer to call the vote.
York.
Aye.
Toledo.
Aye.
Healy.
Aye.
Levin, absent. Kennedy.
Aye.
Honquist.
Aye.
Wagner.
Aye.
Mulliner.
Aye.
Deuter.
Aye.
Sabatino.
Aye.
Leader.
Aye.
Dunn.
Aye.
Graham.
Aye.
Malumski.
Aye.
13 ayes, 0 nays, 1 absent.
13 ayes, 0 nays, motion carries. On to agenda item 8.2, another report out of finance. Clerk Spencer.
It is therefore the recommendation of the Finance, Council Affairs, and Administrative Services Committee that the City Council authorize the refunding of the 2009 General Obligation Bond issue as detailed above. Signed by Kevin L. York, Chairman, Bob Dunn, Vice Chairman, Noel P. Toledo, and Mark P. Sabatino.
Okay, to put this before council, I'll ask for a motion to approve the report and recommendation as read. Motion by Alderman York, second by Alderman Dunn. Alderman York, more bond stuff. This is good news?
Yeah, this is good news, Your Honor. Every once in a while, we have the opportunity to take a debt situation and improve it, and that's exactly what we have here today. So, as everybody can read, basically this is like when you refinance your house. We're refinancing the debt on a bond obligation that we let in 2009. The net effect is going to be that on a present value basis, we're going to save about $480,000 over the duration of the bonds. So about another 12 years we'll save this money. So this is a good thing. And one other thing, Alderman Toledo's comments apply here. You see all the numbers there. With this refunding, it's a market event. So what we're the reports try and make clear that the consultants will work with city staff and decide which one goes to market first, the issuing of the new GO bonds or the refunding of the existing GO bonds. And they have to be 15 days apart. So we can't do, and we always have to do the ordinance on the day they're sold. So it always has to be a Monday. Well, there's more than 15 days between two Mondays. So, there's fewer than 15 days between two Mondays. So, we're going to figure all that out. We've given the city staff and the consultants a leeway to get them in the right order and get them sequenced properly. But at the end of the day, we expect savings of about $480,000. So good news.
Okay. Any other comments?
Clerk Spencer.
York.
Aye.
Paluto.
Aye.
Healy.
Aye.
Levin, absent. Kennedy.
Aye.
Conquest.
Aye.
Wagner.
Aye.
Mulliner.
Aye.
Deuter.
Aye.
Sabatino.
Aye.
Leader.
Aye.
Dunn.
Aye.
Graham.
Aye.
Polumsky.
Aye.
13 ayes, 0 nays, 1 absent.
13 ayes, 0 nays, motion carries. 8.2, agenda item 8.2 is approved. On to ordinances, 9.1. Clerk Spencer, this is an ordinance, and I ask that you read the ordinance.
An ordinance approving and authorizing the execution of the redevelopment agreement by and between New Home Star, and the City of Elmhurst, Illinois.
Okay, to put this before council, I ask for a motion to approve the ordinance as read. Motion by Alderman Mulliner, second by Alderman Honquist. Alderman Mulliner.
We debated this a week ago, and I think everybody knows what this is all about. This is an opportunity for a development within the City of Elmhurst, two properties that have not been utilized to their fullest extent, and we have an opportunity for a builder, a developer to occupy one almost immediately, and then over a period of 5 years, develop another one that's sitting right in front of it. And this is the ordinance putting that into play.
Okay, any comments? Alderman Polumsky.
Thank you, Mayor. Less than a year ago, this council updated our downtown plan, taking into consideration planning consultants' recommendations and resident input. In that plan are guidelines for design, appearance, and quality materials. I think when the city invests in a downtown project, residents expect us to use those guidelines as requirements. I appreciate the committee adding some detail into this after their meeting last week. That was not in the TIF assistance report we looked at last full council meeting, but those design guidelines are not addressed. I talked with Assistant City Manager Mike Kopp, and he spoke with a representative from New Home Star about our design guidelines. That representative said that they are willing to meet these, and I would argue help ensure that our new development fulfills the vision that our residents have for our downtown. So I would like to make a motion to amend the RDA.
Okay. With what you submitted, or do you want to read it?
I can read it.
It's up to you.
Yep. So here is the amendment. Whereas the project shall be developed and constructed in accordance with the 2016 downtown plan design guidelines, including but not limited to the following: architectural style, building materials, doors and entrances, windows, roof lines, and parapets.
Okay, so we have a motion to insert this whereas language as read by Alderman Polumsky and provided to me before the meeting in writing, much appreciated. Page 3, Exhibit A, inserted between paragraph 1 and paragraph 2 on page 3. Whereas the project shall be developed and constructed in accordance with the 2016 downtown plan design guidelines, included but not limited to the following: architectural style, building materials, doors and entrances, windows, roof lines, and parapets. We have a motion to insert this. Do I have a second to insert this? Second by Alderman Deuter. Okay. Any discussion? Alderman Toledo?
Yeah, there's a couple of page 3s, I think.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Specifically
on, go to Exhibit A, which is page 2, physical page 2. And in Exhibit A, page 3, the very top of page 3 starts with whereas the project shall be developed. Let me know when you get there.
Going down to the exhibits. Okay. Exhibit A, legal description.
Exhibit A, redevelopment agreement.
I think you're too far.
Are there multiple Exhibit A's?
One is an exhibit to the exhibit that the mayor is referring to is the exhibit to the resolution.
So it's at the top. It's actually page 3.
Take the exhibit.
The ordinance, you mean?
Or ordinance, excuse me.
Gotta keep you on your toes, Don.
Look at the top, it says page 6 of 37.
So Exhibit A.
Okay, page 6 of 37 if you're following at home on the PDF.
Right,
It's page 6 of 37.
Page 6 of 37.
Which one is it at? Hold on. Okay, I'm going back up. I just want to make sure I know where the language
Understand.
Is going.
Or computer issues, Alderman York.
I know. Got to get these things fixed. At least it's hers, not yours.
I have a hard copy, Alderman Toledo, if you'd like.
That might be helpful.
Let's do that.
Happy to oblige.
That's you right there.
The ordinance.
You're on it now.
Should I have the bar that says please? Right there. You can look at it.
Okay.
Okay. Clarified where it's going. Now that you know where it is, Alderman Toledo, do you have additional comments or questions?
No, thank you.
Alderman Mulliner.
As the committee that put this this ordinance together, we support this. We don't have a problem with this. At least
okay.
I don't.
Alderman Dunn, then I'll go to Alderman Bram.
I also would support that. I think that the downtown plan is very well thought through, and we should be following those guidelines with every project, and with the applicant being supportive of incorporating those, I think it's a good suggestion.
Okay. Alderman Bram or Alderman Deuter. Alderman Deuter?
Thank you, Mayor. Thank you, Alderman Bram. You know, I also wholeheartedly support the addition of this amendment. I think it should be applicable in every case, but it, in particular with this case, because we have a project that's, I think, brought before us in a somewhat unusual fashion. We haven't seen renderings. You know, the RDA includes parameters around the size of the project, a minimum size, but we really don't know much more about it. So I think at a minimum, adhering to the design guidelines makes a lot of sense.
Okay, any other comments? Alderman Bram.
Thank you. Albeit I support the amendment, I don't support this as a whole, as discussed 2 weeks ago. But there's one new thing that came to light when I started to review this ordinance that encompassed the RDA. There's great discussion when we were talking about the report, and this is why the details in a report are so crucial or critical. The RDA does not ensure that the building that they are proposed to move into will remain. It may remain when they buy the gas station and decide to build on the gas station lot, and they might connect to it or they might not. But they also may demolish the proposed initial building behind the gas station on Second and demolish it altogether. And that's what I stated 2 weeks ago. I'll state again, that's a waste of city resident funds to not ensure that those dollars aren't wasted 2 to 5 years later, whatever the case may be. So that's point one. Point two, though, when looking through this ordinance, it doesn't even comply with our TIF incentive policy that we as a council have passed and have supported in the past. And what I mean by that is that the one bullet item that I took note of was in here, it states that any equity stake of 7.5% ownership or greater, which is a state statute, must declare. And what I mean by declare is say who it is, what corporation, et cetera. Our own TIF policy is more strict than that and says 5% or greater. So I'm not sure on why we're being more lenient and ignoring our own TIF policy that we created and we supported. So that's a concern for me. I don't know why there's that discrepancy. Before the meeting today, I spoke with the city attorney and assistant city manager Mike Kopp. Assistant City Manager Mike Kopp stated to me that our policy has been to follow the state statute. I guess shame on me to a certain degree that I've only caught it on this one, but nonetheless, I think we should be following our TIF policy, which I don't even know if what is being stated here, this request for these dollars, even meet the requirements for the TIF policy. I have concern for that. Especially the $85,000 that could be, you know, going to waste a few years down the line. So I applaud Alderman Palumski's motion to amend with the details of the physical structure and how it should look like and blend into the rest of this area, the outskirts of our downtown per se, or in our downtown technically. But I can't support this overall due to those multiple reasons.
Okay, any other comments? Seeing none, I will remind council before I ask Clerk Spencer for the vote that we are voting to on the motion to amend. We're not voting on the overall ordinance at this time. We're voting on whether or not to amend Alderman Palumski's motion, amend it per Alderman Palumski's motion. Is anybody in council unclear on the motion and need me to read it again? Okay, everyone appears to be clear on the motion to amend. Clerk Spencer, please call the vote on the motion to amend.
York.
Aye.
Toledo.
Aye.
Healy.
Aye.
Levin absent. Kennedy.
Aye.
Conquist.
Aye.
Wagner.
Aye.
Mulliner.
Aye.
Deuter.
Aye.
Sabatino.
Aye.
Leader.
Aye.
Dunn.
Aye.
Graham.
No.
Palumski.
Aye.
12 ayes, 1 nays, 1 absent.
12 ayes, 1 nay. Motion to amend carries. The ordinance before us is so amended. On to the now amended motion. Any additional comments? Alderman Deuter.
Thank you, Mayor. I expressed some concerns at the last meeting about this, about the report. I continue to have those concerns, so I'm not going to vote for the ordinance that's before us. And, you know, one of the concerns, I think one of the, I don't think I said this last meeting, there's an assumption in the redevelopment agreement that this applicant has the capacity and the resources available to see this development through. I think the RDA actually includes a requirement that they're putting in a 10% equity stake in the project. And then if you back up to the TIF assistance that's for their relocation and the renovation, the build out of their perhaps temporary space, or perhaps, you know, it'll be part of the final project. But the assumption is they wouldn't be able to get that project done but for the assistance from the city. And so in that case, I'm thinking of the $85,000 that's the relocation assistance and the build out resources, and thinking how can the applicant that needs our resources to make that part of the project happen not be, you know, they don't have those resources available, but they have the capacity to ultimately get this final project done. So I still have a lot of questions and uncertainty about how this moves forward. I think the design guidelines takes away some of that uncertainty, at least in what the final product hopefully will look like. So I'm not going to support the final project for those reasons.
Thank okay. You. Any other comments? Clerk Spencer.
York.
Aye.
Toledo.
Aye.
Healy.
Aye.
Levin absent. Kennedy.
Aye.
Conquist.
Aye.
Wagner.
Aye.
Mulliner.
Aye.
Deuter.
No.
Sabatino.
Aye.
Leader.
Aye.
Dunn.
Aye.
Graham.
No.
Palumski.
Aye.
11 ayes, 2 nays, 1 absent.
11 ayes, 2 nays. Motion carries. Agenda item 9.1 is approved. On to 9.2, Clerk Spencer, it's an ordinance, and I ask that you read it for the record.
An ordinance approving and authorizing the execution of the redevelopment agreement by and between 100 North Addison, LLC, and the City of Elmhurst, Illinois.
Okay, to put this before council, I'll ask for a motion to approve the ordinance as read. Motion by Alderman Mulliner, second by Alderman Conquest. Alderman Mulliner.
This too is another ordinance that is just setting in place the rules for the redevelopment as it relates to the Opus project at Addison, at 100 Addison.
Okay. Comments? Alderman Dunn.
Last week, when we discussed this, I had a lot of issues with the project, and I think it was more of a lack of information on the project. I want to thank city staff for putting together economic projections on this project, because that's where I was sort of left high and dry on how to evaluate this, the value of this project to the city. And Based on the projected increment of this $53 million project coming into our downtown, the increased EAV, which is creating that increment, we would generally see a payback on that in 3 years. And I think that's, in spite of the other objections I've had with the building materials and the maybe not being consistent with our downtown plan and our design guidelines, the retail on the first floor, but with that payback, I think it's a compelling reason. In addition to the sales tax that will be generated from what retail is planned to go in there, so at this point, I would support this project because of the financial implications for the city. Thanks.
Okay. Any additional comments? Alderman Palomski.
Thank you, Mayor. I appreciate the contribution this will make to our city, but as I stated a couple weeks ago, I don't support investing in a project that does not meet our design guidelines. Thanks.
Okay. Any additional comments? Clerk Spencer.
York.
Aye.
Toledo.
Aye.
Healy.
Aye.
Levin, absent. Kennedy.
Aye.
Hornquist.
Aye.
Wagner.
Aye.
Mulliner.
Aye.
Deuter.
No.
Sabatino.
Aye.
Leader.
Aye.
Dunn.
Aye.
Graham.
No.
Palomski.
No.
10 ayes, 3 nays, 1 absent.
10 ayes, 3 nays. Motion carries. Agenda item 9.2 is approved. On to agenda item 10, reports and recommendations of appointed elected officials. Mayor Morley, that's me. Real quick, it's my honor and pleasure this morning to swear in 2 firefighters. I'm happy to say that brings our firefighting department up to full staff. I think that's a good thing. And these 2 young men are gonna, you should have seen, we had early voting here, so we had to swear them in I think conference room 2. And we couldn't fit even a quarter of the people that came to see these young men get sworn in. It was really something. One kid brought only half his family and it was like 30 people. So very happy to say sworn 2 firefighters, and also happy to report that this Friday I'll be swearing in 4 new police officers. We've had some retirements and we'll be swearing in 4 new police officers. That's it for my report. I'm gonna jump on to 10.2, which is also for me to handle. It's the beginning of a bad joke. What do you get when you put 150 engineers in one room? You get the American Public Works Association awards ceremony. That's about how the jokes went over at the award ceremony too. This is like the Academy Awards for Public Works. It's the best way I can put it. And I can tell you this, we were the only city there that had 2 awards. It's very impressive. We are in august company. Our Public Works Department and Kent Johnson and Howard and everybody deserves all the credit. We actually won the award for Project of the Year for environment less than $5 million. And basically it was our Tree Streets project where we are providing 20 acre feet of relief to that neighborhood. And the way it was, not only the way it was designed, the way we finished it by, I'm not gonna use the engineering term, but blowing up the side of the quarry. We saved ourselves $400,000 just in the way they engineered that controlled explosion. So it was a great event, and I can tell you, our engineers were there and all of their peers were there, and it was quite an honor just to be there. We want to extend our congratulations to Howard Killian and the folks at Burke and everybody involved. It really, Elmhurst shone very well at that meeting. We also have an individual award that we're not gonna be talking about tonight because that man, as a
result of his dedication to Public Works is actually in Springfield, lobbying on our behalf. So we're going to bring him back for another specific call out. But I want to say thanks to Howard and everybody for the project award. So congratulations. City Manager Grabowski.
Two items before I get to 10.4. The first is we sent out a notice to everybody, but at the Public Affairs and Safety Committee two meetings ago, we discussed the DUCOM expansion and new construction. And so that memo was put on to the board doc site under that committee. If you have any questions, please feel free to contact me. The second item is an update on the downtown rezoning. As you know, in accordance with the downtown plan, we undertook one of the objectives in there was to kind of simplify the zoning ordinance, and so we've been going about that. Staff has held two open house meetings for that, and they've both been very successful with a significant number of residents coming in to ask questions. As a result of that, and certainly as some of the aldermen know, you've been contacted by various residents in the area with concerns or questions. And so we've taken those under advisement. And I know in a few of those situations, we've made a decision that we've put in writing and is on the board doc site that perhaps we need to make some changes to the plan as proposed. So those are all on the board doc site under two different cases, 17P04 and 05. And also if you go to the city website and then after elmhurst.org/downtown rezoning, we have a web page that I think best explains that to the residents. So that all leads up to Thursday, March 23rd, this Thursday at 7 p.m., which is the public hearing. And that will be in conference room 2. Oh, it's here. Okay. Are you sure with early voting? We've worked it out. It'll be in this room. Thank you very much, Assistant Manager Cobb. Thursday, March 23rd, 7 p.m. Public hearing here. That recommendation will then go to DPZ committee and then on to City Council, of course. Mr. Kopp, if you can pull up the
Mr. Mayor, before we move on, may I just...
Yeah, Alderman Bram.
I just wanted to address a comment that one of the residents made today about our police station. Our police station foundation is fine. It is not crumbling. We did have issues with the pillars outside of the police station, but the physical police station structure is fine. So by adding the air conditioning unit, we're not throwing away money, and the police station is not going to be rolling off down the Robert Palmer Drive anytime soon. So I just wanted to address that because I don't want that to get out to the public like we have issues with our police station.
Okay. City Manager, the floor is yours.
Thank you. So one more presentation, and I'll try to be quick with this. This has been a few months in the making now. It's gotten put off a couple of times due to time constraints. And it's regarding the O'Hare expansion and also an opportunity to update the council on the runway rotation plan, which has changed a little bit since we originally put this together. First, I want to start by thanking Arlinda Barjrami in the back. Wave, Arlinda, thank you. She is our administrative intern and did all of the work in researching this and putting this together. So thank you very much for that. Mike, my remote is not working, so I think you're going to have to move those, advance the slides. Okay, so... approximately a year ago, Chicago announced an expansion of the terminals and gates at O'Hare Airport. After that announcement, Mayor Morley and I met with the leadership at O'Hare Airport, the general manager there, who works under the Commissioner of Aviation. He's the chief operating officer. And we also met with their lead engineer to discuss what that meant for O'Hare and, of course, what that means to the residents of Elmhurst. I know the mayor shared a few of those details with the city council approximately a month or two ago. So that is creating a new international runway. And these are items that we took from cranes that were put out mainly by the city of Chicago, but supports 6,000 jobs. The goal is to shorten time passengers spend on the plane once they land. As a lot of you know, if you land on the northernmost or southernmost runway, you can spend 20 to 30 minutes taxiing through O'Hare to get to your gate. So they're trying to shorten that up. They want to increase the passenger departure rate, which we'll get to in a second, decrease costs to the airlines, ensure that O'Hare has the newest and most efficient runway system, and then also as part of that, they're in renegotiations for lease agreements with United and American Airlines, which expire in 2018. It's interesting right now, what they told us is that a number of the gates are vacant, but the those two airlines hold on to them because they want to limit the competition at the airport. So the renegotiation that they have, they expect will free up some gates in addition to the construction that they're going to move forward with. Mike, if you can advance that. The next one shows the passenger departure growth rates. As I indicated before, they've discovered at O'Hare that they have not kept up with their competition of most major airports throughout the United States. And so they are looking to move into a more acceptable rate along with the nation's largest commercial airports because O'Hare lags behind, and so that's why they want to increase the gates. So now we'll get to a slide that you've seen before as I've updated the council on runway completion. Under construction right now is runway 9C, 9 Center, 27 Center, which is the tan, the longest tan on the north end, thank you. And then after that will be the expansion of the runway just below that, which would be 9 right, 27 left, I believe. So as part of the 9 Center, 27 Center, they broke ground on that in August of 2016. It will be the newest and second largest runway at O'Hare. It'll be 11,245 feet long and 200 feet wide. The important part is that it'll help balance noise exposure among communities east and west of the airport. As everybody knows, in October of 2013, when they changed the orientation of the airport, airport noise decreased significantly for communities to the southwest, northeast, northwest and southeast, and increased significantly for communities to the west side and the east side of the airport, including the city of Chicago. So this runway will be built in two phases, and then in addition to that, two new hangars and some other airfield projects such as new taxiways and de-icing pads are being added. It's being funded by the FAA, passenger facility charges and aviation bonds, and it will be completed in the year 2020. Again, the other significant portion of this construction is that it completes the O'Hare Modernization Program, which, as I said before, shifts the daytime traffic significantly to the east side and the west side as they go to east flow, west flow. And the fact that it's on the north side of the airport is significant for the city of Elmhurst because it will allow traffic further away from the city of Elmhurst as they depart and arrive, which generally headed at take off at a heading to the northwest or northeast as they avoid the south side of the airport so they can use those runways as well. So Mike, if you can skip ahead two slides. This gets us to the redevelopment portion of it. So Terminal 2 redevelopment, and actually Mike, you can go to the next slide because that'll show it graphically. So what they're going to do is demolish the oldest terminal, Terminal 2. They're going to add some international gates and new customs facilities to this. The custom facility would include a departure hall with additional space for TSA screenings, concessions, and other passenger amenities. The gate additions here at Terminal 2 are about 5 to 7 years to complete, and they estimate the entire project at 8 to 10 years to complete. So that would then allow for additional flights on the runways, obviously, as they build more gates to this. So they have 42 gates currently. They're unsure of the exact number that this addition will add to the number of gates in Terminal 2. And the cost estimate is from the CDA Commissioner Ginger Evans at billions of dollars is all that she gave to this reporter that we got this from. Next slide shows Terminal 3 expansion, which is just, it's down and it's to the east of the Terminal 2. In this picture, the Terminal 2 addition is kind of a teal color, and just to the right of that, it would be the Terminal 3 expansion. And so that's an addition of 5 new gates on Concourse L. This project will coincide with plans to add 2 new hotels in the redevelopment of the Hilton that's on site already. And that estimated cost for that is $70 million, and it's being funded by American Airlines. What we got from them is that permits have been issued for this project, and so it should be underway in pretty short order. And then finally, Terminal 5. They don't have a map for this one. You can see it on that previous slide. This is right now known as the International Terminal. What they're going to do is add 25 gates. I'm sorry, it has 25 gates right now. They're going to add 9 gates to this and make it not only international, but also domestic. And it'll allow discount carriers such as Spirit, Frontier, and JetBlue to fly in and out of there. It supports an estimated 1,100 jobs. And this is funded by O'Hare Revenue's passenger seat charges. And the completed project for this is 2019 at an estimated cost of $300 million. So that's what we know about the O'Hare expansion plan. There's not great detail for all the projects. I would admit that. We did scour many resources for that. We've asked many people, and these are about all the details that we could get. So I'd like to go on and talk a little bit about the O'Hare Fly Quiet program.
Do you want to take expansion questions now or take everything at the end?
I'd prefer to get through this and then we can
Let's get through it, Alderman Bram, and then we'll answer all questions.
So if everyone recalls, the O'Hare Fly Quiet runway rotation program was a 6-month test. Mike, can you flip that slide? Thank you. 6-month test between July 6th of 2016 and December 25th of 2016. On average, the test began at 11:16 p.m. and ended at 5:25 a.m. with an average of 65 operations per night. It was held over summer, fall, and winter seasons to evaluate the impact of the weather, seasonal conditions, and construction on the airport. As part of that, the CDA asked residents surrounding the airport to complete a survey on their website to register any complaints that they had. So they received 6,160 surveys from 3,837 respondents. So there were multiple surveys completed by various people, and that came from 84 different communities in Chicagoland. So they were able to measure that. We'll get to that in just a second as far as Elmhurst goes, but they were able to register exactly where those IP addresses came from. CDA reported that 67% of the aircraft operations that occurred during the fly quiet hours utilized the designated rotation runways. And what that means is in the rotation plan, they had a designated runway and an alternative runway in the event that weather, wind, construction, something else on the airport necessitated a different runway use. But unless the FAA designated that outright, pilots had the opportunity to call in to the tower in advance of their landing to request a different runway. So if a pilot wasn't comfortable with the length of a certain runway, they could request a different runway, a longer runway to either depart or arrive on. But 67% of the time, the aircraft used the runway that was being designated for that evening. So the next slide shows the runway rotation test results for Elmhurst specifically. So they have these for each community on the ONCC website, which shows the number of complaints that were registered by Elmhurst residents. And what we did, we circled the weeks on there where the designated runways pointed at Elmhurst. So that was four right, 22 left, or possibly even four left or 22 right. So the ones that point southwest and northeast. And you can see in that first week, significant number of complaints registered on the survey site. But then as the program wore on, And I did not correlate this with weather or anything like that to see what the outside temperatures might have been, if people had windows open or not. We did not correlate it with that. You can see the bumps, though, as we go along with the that correspond to the runway use, that point at Elmhurst. And as I said, they had these for every community. So the next slide shows the runway configurations and the usage that they had. They had a very lengthy review of the program on the ONCC website. I've spared you some of the details and a lot of the pages from that, but you can feel free to go to the ONCC website and take a look at that. So as I said, this shows the runway configurations which were used for the first test and also the percentage used. That's what the bar graph on the bottom shows. And so the configurations that affected Elmhurst were configuration D and I. And I say affected us, and when I say that, I mean directly with the two runways that really angle towards Elmhurst. As I indicated before, maybe alluded to, when pilots use the east-west configuration, their headings sometimes they turn, so they will fly over. They try to track down 294, possibly 83. They try to track over forest preserves, industrial parks, whenever they can. Sometimes it's unavoidable, but certainly at nighttime, during fly quiet hours, they're able to do that. So configuration I, which is the departures off 22 left and the arrivals on 22 right. The arrivals don't affect us because that comes in from the northeast, but the departures off 22 left affect us. And as I see it, and as I'm told, those pilots are told to bank left and then follow down 294. But that was the fourth bar graph down, so that was used 53% of the time. And then the next one was configuration D, where it's arrivals on 4 right, and it was departures off 1533, which is out to the northwest, and that was used 42% of the time. So the program concluded. The ONCC put together an ad hoc group to assess whether this worked or not, and that was made up of 8 people from the ONCC. They asked the Chicago Department of Aviation to look at a second runway rotation test. There are some on the committee that just wanted the relief to continue for the communities immediately east and west of the airport. There are others that wanted to truly test another phase without runway 1533, which I'll get to in a second, to see what that rotation might look like and how it would sound. This small group met a few times to review this and ultimately made a recommendation to the ONCC board to try, it's interesting the way it played out, because they made a recommendation to the ONCC, but then at the ONCC board meeting, the chairman of that ad hoc group asked for it to be deferred and be sent back to the small group for reevaluation. And there was some discussion at the larger ONCC board, which forced the vote and ultimately approved a 3-month test. And I'll get to that in a second. The ad hoc runway rotation program group voted, as I said, on a 6-2 vote to recommend that to the ONCC, and then ONCC ultimately voted on that a couple weeks ago. But let me talk a little bit about what those changes are. The next slide shows the runways that are used during the runway rotation plan. So it basically excludes the southernmost runway and the northernmost runway, and the reason for that is because the towers that that guide the airlines in on those or the airplanes in on those two runways are not manned in overnight, and so they generally don't use those. But what the mayor and I heard at the meeting we had with the Chicago Department of Aviation was really the flight controllers prefer to use the east-west configuration. It's a lot easier for them. They I don't think they care to have to rotate the runways. They just like to look at the weather conditions and make the call on which runways to use. So this is really being forced on them by the Chicago Department of Aviation. But as I said before, safety is number one. And so if a pilot calls in and says, I need a different runway, they're going to defer to the pilot and say, that's fine. I think we'd all want that, right? So the next slide shows some changes that they made to the configurations. So the configurations in the black boxes are going to stay. The configurations in the red boxes are going to change. And the configurations in the green boxes are the new ones that replace the red boxes. So there's two of them that affect Elmhurst that change. One that changes, actually. It's letter I changes to letter D changes to letter L. So D is the configuration that has the arrivals on 4 right and departures off 1533. And what they're doing is they're changing that. They're keeping, as Mike has indicated with the hand icon, that it'll still be arrivals on 4 right, but it'll be departures off of 24 left. So going in the same flow. And the next slide shows that with just a little bit more detail, or it increases so you can see it a little bit better. So the change really affects the northwest suburbs more than it does Elmhurst. As a reminder, the next slide shows what the ONCC laid out as their goals and guidelines for the runway rotation program. It was to alternate east and west flow, avoid consecutive community impacts, balance the runway use, and then the process they were going to use is conduct a test and monitor the results. So as I said, the ONCC board had a meeting a week ago, and Alderman Dunn was there as a representative of Elmhurst. The small group came in and suggested that they wait a couple of weeks until they could further discuss the new program. There was some discussion and a motion made by two of the members to take a vote and to make it a 3-month test rather than a 6-month test. So what they're going to do is include runway 1533. That's a runway that's going to be decommissioned in the next few years. That's the one that points toward Arlington Heights and Mount Prospect. That's going to be decommissioned because for the east-west flow and the runways that are being constructed, it needs to go away for safety reasons. So the 3-month test will use 1533. Which is actually better for us because that includes one more runway in the rotation. So it defers it just a little bit more from flying over Elmhurst. And then it's my expectation that they will come back with a recommendation for another 3-month test without 1533 in it to see how that goes. So the next slide shows the review that they used to evaluate. And what I just said, that they will reduce use of runway 10 left, 28 right, include runway 1533, conduct the test, monitor performance, and then go through another ONCC review. But I anticipate after that 3 months, they will very quickly go to another 3-month test. And the reason that those numbers are significant is the FAA limits tests like this to 6 months. And unless they were going to change something, they couldn't just do another 6-month test with the same rotation that they did. FAA wouldn't allow that because that's really not a test at that point. So then the next slide and the last slide shows what happened. In February, the small group voted on it. In March, the ONCC approved it. This now goes to the Chicago Department of Aviation and FAA for approval. I anticipate this will be implemented sometime in May for the 3-month test. That's my report, Mayor. I'm happy to answer any questions.
Thank you. City Manager, any questions or comments? Alderman Bram.
Thank you. Thank you, City Manager Grabowski, for this overview in regards to O'Hare and how it impacts, or how it's proposed to impact Elmhurst. I do want to start with the first half
and then backtrack to the Fly Quiet program. And that is in regards to the expansion and runway rotation plans. I see a lot of the slides are referencing various articles, local papers, et cetera. What I'm missing, and maybe you can speak to this, is the data that really does speak to how does this really impact Elmhurst. And I think that's what I asked months ago. I do understand there's the changes at Terminal 2, Terminal 3, Terminal 5. I have done some research on my own, and I have seen the added gates that are proposed in some of these articles. But I guess what contacts have been made with either the FAA or Chicago Department of Aviation or both to find out what does that mean from an increased flight volume perspective? And then, you know, how does that translate into impacting Elmhurst? That is what I care about. That is what my residents care about, since this does impact mostly, not only, but mostly the north side of Elmhurst. And I have heard from residents outside of the third ward in regards to this fly rotation program and how it's impacted them. But I don't see anything that says how many flights are going to be, what is the increase in flights, and therefore how is that going to impact Elmhurst at all within this part of the slides. I appreciate the background, the cost that either the airlines or Chicago or whomever is going to need to pick up, or the hangars or the hotel and everything else they're proposing, and how long these runways are going to be. Sure. But when the rubber hits the road, no pun intended, I guess I'll wait.
Go ahead, Alderman Bram. I just had one question. Go ahead.
When the rubber hits the road, it's about how it's impacting us as a city, and I don't see anywhere in here that my questions from months ago have been answered of what will impact the city of Elmhurst. Where's the number of flight increase? The city of Chicago, as well as the FAA, must know, in addition of X number of gates, how many additional flights there's going to be. I mean, the Chicago Department of Aviation has O'Hare for just a short period of time, as well as Midway. So I'm confused on why we aren't able to get that information. And I know you stated that you made a request, but really, all these slides are telling me is what O'Hare plans to do, what Chicago plans to do, and not how it will impact us, and what is the city of Elmhurst doing to prevent it from impacting us. So that's the first big question.
Well, I can say this, Alderman Bram, is that a lot of the questions that you're seeking, there are not answers to.
How can that be?
Well, I'm going to explain it. As the city manager mentioned in one of the slides, you got O'Hare, you got American and United that actually are currently paying the hold gates empty. This is there's two things happening here. There's the Fly Quiet thing that's happening, and then there's the runway, there's the O'Hare expansion, and ultimately the build out of O'Hare. If you're currently one of the airlines that enjoys O'Hare to its fullest, you're going to be resistant to any change, and you're going to negotiate the best you can with the expansion. And that's exactly what's happening with the big players that are at O'Hare right now and the changes that are happening. So when you ask a question like how many flights are coming in and how many gates are coming in, they have projections, but they have not finalized their lease yet with either one of the two big airlines. As you can imagine, expansion will mean more competition, and the negotiations, and this is the part that they can't share with us, the negotiations with the airlines about this expansion are ongoing. So there are no hard and fast, this is how many flights will be increased, because they don't really know how many gates they're going to end up negotiating for. So they can project, but a lot of this has to do with them coming to the table when their current leases expire with American and United, which I think is in 2 years.
Mm-hmm. I think next year, 2018.
Okay, 2018. So all of this stuff, it's all what if at this point, and we're not going to get a solid answer out of it. The expansion in general, as I've said in the past, the expansion of O'Hare and the overall O'Hare Modernization Plan will ultimately be a benefit for Elmhurst. Now, I don't know, City Manager, Assistant City Manager Kopp, can you pull up the map that has the two runways that we're lengthening, north and south? Do you know which slide that would be? This is kind of like Tinker Toys. That's the one. Every single change at one part of O'Hare changes another part. Sometimes it goes away altogether. But here's an example. There are only certain runways that can take certain size equipment right now. So if you're on a bigger piece of equipment, you only can go on certain runways. Well, this is good news right here, okay? So this is a creation of another runway and an expansion of a short runway right now that can't take a big piece of equipment. So here's an example where we can say there's going to be more flights, but there's going to be more flights east and west, and that's a good thing for Elmhurst. But we're not going to have any definitive numbers until O'Hare has signed all of their leases with all of their carriers. We know it's going to be more. I've said this in the past as well, is that O'Hare will be more efficient, and they acknowledge this, that O'Hare itself runs more efficient when it runs east-west. It's more efficient from an operation standpoint. It's more often during weather conditions, it's more efficient from a safety standpoint. This Fly Quiet program is more of a political football that's really kind of a fly in the ointment. So I understand you're looking for answers, but until O'Hare finalizes their deal with the expansion, finalizes which airlines are going to come in, finalizing what gates the existing airlines are going to get, and it's a little bit of a crystal ball because these guys are constantly trying to figure out what equipment is going to be used for the next 20 or 30 years, and that changes. So all of those unknowns while they negotiate result in, we know it's going to be more, but we don't know the specific impact for Elmhurst. The overall build out is designed for east-west, and that's better for Elmhurst. Alderman Braham.
Thank you. I appreciate that we don't know the exact numbers, but you yourself, Mayor, just stated that we know projections. There's been nothing discussed in this presentation about projections. What is the max capacity per gate? That is known. Not saying that they'll reach max capacity in regards to each gate, but what is the max capacity? These are questions that myself has that has to be known by the FAA and the Chicago Department of Aviation, and we should have already asked and found out those answers by now. I don't know, as mentioned by yourself, there's projections. Well, why haven't those projections been presented in this presentation? What are those projections? How many exact gates are there going to be? Or proposed gates are going to be?
Alderman Braham, I just told you we don't know.
No, just, Mr. Mayor, you said in your own rebuttal to my comments was we know the projections. That's what you stated.
I said there are projections, okay? I could ask them today how many gates are going in. I can ask them tomorrow how many gates are going in. And they don't know how many airplanes can go to a specific gate because they don't know which equipment's going. Because different size gates can handle different size airplanes. These are unknowns, Alderman Braham. If we had the information, they'd give it to us. They don't have the information. We've asked.
I see a presentation that is quotes and data just from articles that I myself have already read and looked at. If we have spoken with the Department of Aviation, the FAA, I would guess, just like when they did a presentation here before, that they could give us additional information that is not in articles today. So I do have concerns. I doubt that they have absolutely no idea in regards to the increase. I'm not saying for solidified numbers, but they should have some idea in regards to the increase. I mean, this hasn't been done within the last couple of months. So I beg to differ, Mr. Mayor, that nobody has the answers here in regards to what O'Hare is going to look like in these upcoming years when they're talking about significant, quoted by Mayor Emanuel, significant terminal and gate expansion. Significant. And I mentioned this 6, 7, 8 months ago here on the dais. That was the quote. This presentation, I expected to have some definition of what significant means. And albeit this is a great summary of what is proposed, but how does it impact? That was my request 6, 7 or however many months ago, how does it impact Elmhurst, or what is proposed on how it would impact Elmhurst? So I appreciate this, and I appreciate this from an overall view, especially for the residents of Elmhurst, but we can't continue to just wait for them to tell us information. I'm not saying it hasn't been asked, but we need to continue to ask before it's too late. Will it be best if it goes east-west? Sure, but we're doing a Fly Quiet program, and it's being extended for round two. And the Fly Quiet program, according to what this presentation shows, is that it's adding an additional rotation from two runways to three, or two configurations to three configurations, that will impact Elmhurst. So not only the original Fly Quiet rotation would have two configurations that would impact us, if they move forward with what is proposed for this upcoming 3 months, there'll be three. So Elmhurst gets hit more. And with that said, I don't think Elmhurst should say, well, it's better than what it was. When we discussed east-west runways for many a decades now, it was newest, safest, and most efficient. If the FAA and the Chicago Department of Aviation and we as the city of Elmhurst believe what's the safest, then the safest should be east-west and no fly rotation program, period. That is reality. And you yourself, Mr. Mayor, made mention that this is the fly rotation program is a political football, and I totally agree with you. But Elmhurst needs to step up to that political football and kick it out of Elmhurst altogether.
Any other comments? Alderman Palumski.
Thank you, Mayor. I just want to thank our Linda, City Manager Grabowski, Alderman Dunn, and you, Mayor, for the background and the presentation.
Okay. Any other comments? Alderman Dunn.
I just want to make a comment. City Manager Grabowski made mention of a survey that was done, and it was interesting that out of all the respondents, the locales that responded, City of Elmhurst was third in number of responses. So we got a lot of activity from our residents. And the actual vote in terms of the Fly Quiet program, the nighttime runway rotation, turned out to be 51% were for the program, 49% were against. So certainly in my mind, that's really not that compelling split to change from normal operations. However, the ONCC makeup is a little more biased in who's on it and their tendencies and what they support. So, you know, naturally the communities that have issues with O'Hare are flocking more to join that. So it's good we're on there, where our voice is being heard to address some of Alderman Bram's concern. That is our best, one of our best avenues, forums to have our voice heard and to have input into what's going on, not only on this runway rotation program, but on other issues as well. Thanks.
Any other comments or questions? Alderman Bram.
A little bit outside of this presentation, but a while back when we were discussing O'Hare modernization, there's also the competing interest of Piatone and the Piatone Airport. Is that dead? Or where is that today?
We'll get back to you. Don't know. Any other comments or questions? Alderman Honquist? No. All right. Other business? Any other business? I'll entertain a motion to adjourn. Motion by Alderman Wagner. Second by Alderman Healy. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? We're adjourned. Thank you, everybody.